Now we're going to move to the next part of the evening, where I'm going to invite three of our postgraduate students to come up on stage and take a seat. So we have Peter Leckis, Susan Christo and Liz Buckley, who are all engaged in a PhD, but in very different areas, and who've come to their PhD in very different ways. So I'm going to start by asking each of them, starting with Liz maybe, why they decided to do a PhD, how come they're doing it at UniSA, and what's their research about?
Well, I've spent the past 6 or so years actually at Adelaide University, where I've been working in public health there and doing epidemiology, translating evidence and research for policy makers to make decisions about public health policy. And during that time, well, when I first started there, I started right at the very bottom of the heap, and I gradually worked my way up with further study. And I realised doing that that I still had a lot to learn about epidemiology, and I also wanted to have more of a say in how some of the research is being done. So when I finished my graduate diploma, I decided that I was either going to do a master's or a PhD, and I thought, why waste my time with a master's and just go on to a PhD? So I started looking around for opportunities to do a PhD. And I spoke to people at Adelaide and at UniSA, and there were a couple of opportunities coming up. The decision to come to UniSA was relatively easy to make in the end. I had a fantastic opportunity with a wonderful supervisor, and they also offered me some money to come here, so it was quite easy in the end. And I certainly don't regret making that decision in any way, so yeah, that's how I came here.
And what's your research question,
Liz? Okay, so I'm looking at the risk of breast cancer and the risk factors for breast cancer after detecting high-risk lesions in a breast screening program, with the aim of hoping to be able to direct treatments towards women at high risk of subsequent breast cancer and to avoid over-treatment in these women.
Terrific. And Susan?
So I was a bit boring and I went from school to uni to honours PhD, so I don't have an exciting story like Liz, but I guess I've always wanted to do research.
I remember in year seven when people would ask me, what do you want to do? I always used to say I want to cure cancer. And for a long time I wanted to do pharmacy because I thought that pharmacy was the only way you could get to drug design. I was really interested in drug design, I was really interested in disease and how we can help prevent disease. And then I came to one of these events at UniSA, and I learnt about a degree called biotechnology. Unfortunately, that degree doesn't exist anymore, but I made that decision to study biotechnology. I loved it so much, I did honours in it, and that just led to PhD. So I guess I've always enjoyed the concept of research and asking questions and answering them, as Tash was saying earlier. Why UniSA? Well, it offered the undergrad degree that I had. In terms of choosing honours, I guess I was very familiar with the academics. I knew what they were about. I knew their style. I loved what UniSA offered. I was comfortable with their facilities. And it really just led from there. And I ended up, I'm doing my PhD now in the same lab that I've done my honours in as well. So we have a focus on immunology. And my, I guess, research area is looking at whether we can develop a platform or a device that can measure your immune system, measure how successful your immune system is. So I look at a particular type of cell called the T cell. And what's so special about the T cell is it's responsible for eliminating any cells that are becoming tumorous or are infected. So in patients that, say, have a tumour, for example, one contributing factor might be that the T cells aren't functioning very well because they're not eliminating these cells, allowing them to grow and form a tumour. So we're trying to develop a device that can actually measure the functionality of a T cell and use this to direct appropriate treatment options for a patient.
Thank you very much. Peter.
Thanks, Anne. I sit here extremely kind of fascinated and very jealous of a lot of the individuals who've kind of spoken before me. They seem to have kind of known what they've wanted to do for quite some time and been very directed, I guess, in terms of their ambitions. When I was starting out as an undergraduate physiotherapy student, research wasn't something that was remotely on my radar at all.
Let me just check. Can you hear Peter at the back? You can? Great.
It was something that we read and something that we applied, but it was something that other kind of people did. It wasn't until some kind of years later where I kind of, like Tasha, I kind of returned to university and undertook a master's degree. But unlike Tasha's, I think mine was more in coursework. But during that kind of coursework, we really were presented with a lot of research and had the opportunities to have a look at research in a different light. And I guess it was kind of at that point in time that I came to kind of enjoy the art of discovery. Why UniSA? Back in 2007, I think it was, the Division of Health Sciences embarked upon an agenda to try and increase the scope of research conducted within the university. At that point in time, a research centre came into being, which I'm part of, the Social Epidemiology and Evaluation Research Group. That group does some quite novel and interesting research across the domains of health and place, complex community intervention evaluation, Indigenous research, rural and remote health research. And in 2008, I had the opportunity to actually kind of meet some of these researchers and to be taken under their wing and actually kind of get involved with some of the research that they're doing. In terms of my research, well, I'm a child of suburbia, and for me, kind of at some kind of innate level, it seems quite natural to actually be looking at suburbia. I'm particularly kind of interested in how suburbs evolve over time from a sociological structural perspective. So the research which I'm involved with takes a life course approach, but it actually takes it at the level of the context. So I'm looking at the life course of a suburb and how that potentially relates to changes in the quality of life of the residents who live within there.
Terrific. Now, you've had enough time to think about a question or two, I hope. Do you have any questions? I've got a list here, I can keep going. But I think if you come with some questions in your head or things you just want to ask, why don't you have a go? So no one has the money question, the how do you survive question. So let's ask the money question. So the question is, how do you support yourself through your PhD? And is it a shock to the system? Is it okay? How does that all work out? Anyone?
I guess I also try to say kind of we, my partner and myself, and our third child, our cat, we have a mortgage. I guess I've kind of been quite fortunate in terms of having received a government-funded APA scholarship, as well as being the recipient of some top-up scholarships as well. The PhD journey kind of allows you to also to work, so you're enabled to work one day a week should you choose to take that option. The government has kind of changed the way it regulates or taxes kind of, or it's changed its tax scales, particularly over the last year. So inherently you can have access to an APA scholarship, top-ups, and work one day a week, and inherently all of that money is tax-free. So from my perspective, life pretty much is as what it is, or was, before I started on this journey.
Interesting. Susan?
I'm probably not the best one to answer this because I don't really have a lot of financial responsibility. I live with my parents. My parents are very supportive, so quite frankly, it's a lot of money for me, so I don't have any like houses to pay. But yeah, as Peter said, it does allow you to work. I sort of chose the internal work in the sense that I got to do some prac demonstrating, and I see some nice, bright, eager students in the audience, and that was really fun. So it's a bit of extra money on the side, but also a great experience.
And Liz?
Well, having been in the workforce before starting a PhD, money was something that I had to think about. I have a young family, a husband, a mortgage. We just increased our mortgage. So I needed a scholarship. I had to find somebody who was prepared to give me one. It was going to be difficult for me because of my... I didn't have the best undergraduate record. So I had to rely on my work experience, I suppose, and my track record doing research as my job. Fortunately, my supervisor saw something in me and wanted to give me a scholarship that was available to him. And it was a very generous scholarship, and he gave me a generous top-up as well. So I've been fortunate enough not to have to work as well, although I do take on some tutoring throughout the year. But I think I had decided before starting the PhD that it didn't, as long as I got a scholarship, it didn't matter how much it was. I didn't care. I was going to do it anyway. It meant that much to me. So,
Okay. Now have we got a question from the audience? So the question, for those who may not have heard it, is the PhD can be perceived as a very all-encompassing thing. It takes all of your time, and there's little time for other things in your life. And the question is, how's that working for you, really?
I guess first thing is you have to be really, really organised and plan out your time. So I find that I do have to plan my weeks, you know, 2 or 3 weeks ahead. If there's a social thing, I actually make time for that. So instead of being like, oh, sorry, I can't come to your party, I'll be like, I'll be there. But, you know, you've got to also organise your work as well. That's all I can think of.
I think it's a perfectly valid kind of question, and it can be quite difficult. From a personal perspective, I'm not necessarily sure whether I always manage it the best. It kind of goes in waves. PhDs require both a breadth of knowledge as well as a depth of knowledge. Having come to my research area as a bit of an outsider, I've sometimes got lost a little bit down the rabbit hole. And I've kind of looked at the entire breadth of research that might be applicable to me. And it's kind of at those kind of moments where you do tend to get quite immersed in your research, and everything else around you becomes quite peripheral. But we're fortunate within the research group that we have that, because we're such a diverse kind of group, we tend to kind of look out for each other. And there are often kind of cues from other kind of students as well that kind of tend to give you a bit of a nudge to try and kind of have a look at your behaviours and potentially kind of change them if it is that you're spending too much time within the institution.
I haven't actually found it to be that difficult to find the right balance. I think having been out in the workforce previously and with the pressures and deadlines associated with work, it hasn't, you know, you learn to be able to manage those, and so transferring, you know, that to a PhD hasn't been that difficult. And in fact, I actually find doing a PhD a lot easier to manage than having a real job, because it tends to be a bit more flexible, and certainly with a family, I found it to be a lot better because of the flexibility associated with the PhD.
Do we have another question? So the question is about after the PhD. How do you construct your career? What are your options? Is it relatively straightforward? So let me ask you guys where you see it going for yourselves, and then I might say a couple of things after that.
At the moment, I'm really, really enjoying research. So I guess kind of in the back of my mind at the moment, I'm considering already at this kind of stage, even though I'm perhaps maybe a year away from completing. I'm already kind of exploring potential kind of postdoctoral kind of opportunities. So there are quite a number of different potential fellowships that will allow you to kind of maintain funding and kind of do the types of research that you are interested in. It is very competitive, but I guess kind of no more competitive than out there in, I guess, the kind of the real or the other alternate kind of employment market. But I think, like Tasha was kind of saying, a PhD kind of equips you with a broad kind of range of skills. So you still have a flexibility potentially to kind of remove yourself or take yourself back away from the university environment and kind of explore other kind of more applied type of options, like potentially kind of industry work within pharmacy or something like that, if that's kind of what you've done. So it's not like a closed door or one kind of pathway option after.
Susan?
Well, me personally, I do also want to follow research career and probably look for postdoc positions. specifically either interstate or overseas. I'd love to go to a different culture, a different lab, a different country. That would be great. I specifically love Germans. I think they're cool. So I want to go to Germany. Love to go there. They've got some really good science. For the science as well. really just as you've heard, you get to travel. Especially in VJ's case, you get to travel the world. So I think it's a great opportunity. If you don't find opportunities in Adelaide, expand your, I guess, world.
And Liz, where do you see it heading?
I'm not really sure yet, and I really don't want to close any doors just yet. I'm trying to keep it as, you know, my options open as much as I can. But I know I want to do research, and I've got 3 years to plan how I'm going or where I'm going to enter or find that job. So I'm using this 3 years to sort of establish relationships, develop relationships, put myself in a position where I would be competitive for a fellowship afterwards. I don't see it as a negative coming into a PhD and not knowing where you're going to go afterwards, because when you're out in the workforce and you're unhappy with your job or for whatever reason you want to change job, you don't often have 3 years to plan it and where you're going to go next. So I see it as a really good opportunity to be able to take your time and work out exactly how you're going to get to a place that you want to go to, really. So, yeah.
I think my comments would be a bit of a composite of what everyone has said so far. The things I would highlight is that when you do research, when you're in the middle of it, it's very tempting to think you've just got these research skills. You've actually got extraordinarily sophisticated transferable skills, which can position you for work in a variety of types of employment situations. The point at which to think about why that's happening, what to do, is actually as you do your PhD, as you've heard people thinking about it, because you will get the opportunities to go to conferences and present your work, and that's when you talk with people and explore the options around what you might do after your PhD. And it's where you can talk with your supervisors and others about options and look to them to do a little bit of that introduction and networking on your behalf initially. I think it's an excellent training where really you can lay claim to having some pretty sophisticated skills, and they do transfer into a range of options. At one stage when I was working elsewhere as head of a department, 3 of our postgrads went into senior positions in the finance and banking industries. They finished their PhDs, they'd worked in laboratories, they'd done bench experiments, and the banks just sucked them up, because what they had were analytical skills, project skills, they could talk about it in ways that made sense to bankers, and they felt they could be a little bit independent in how they conducted their work. And what they needed to know about finance and banking, they'd teach them. So it's quite startling where people can end up as well sometimes. Do we have one last question? So this question is about supervision. What do you look for in a supervisor? How does it all work? The good, the bad, the ugly.
I'll start.
Here for you, Susan.
Well, I'm lucky and I have 4 supervisors actually, which seems like a lot, but they all contribute in different ways. So I guess our 2 lab heads contribute intellectually, and then I have my co-supervisor and my associate supervisor, who are mostly for practical guidance, technical guidance. So if I want to do an experiment, I want to set it up, I'll run it past them and they'll say, oh, okay, well, because I've done this before, I can tell you that, no, 10 mice per group is not a good idea because it would take you 3 hours to do 1 mouse or something like that. So they're very good at understanding what you want to achieve. Sometimes, I will admit, it can be a little bit frustrating because you've got, say, 3 or 4 people, you know, giving you ideas, and they obviously are in a position of authority in the laboratory. They want the project to go a certain way, and I guess as a student you have to make your own decision as to what is best for the project, because you are the one living it, doing it, breathing it, you know, talking about it, dreaming about it, everything. So it can be frustrating, but it's all about character development, really, and you learn how to do that in your PhD, you know. This is, I guess, my first experience of a work environment. I've literally went from uni to honours to PhD, and I get to see how people interact, how you deal with people, how you express ideas and things like that. So that's a good question.
Liz, how about you?
I think supervisors play a really important part in the PhD, and it's really good to find supervisors that you're comfortable with and who are going to contribute what you want to the project, I guess. I've got three supervisors, one here at UniSA, one interstate, and one elsewhere in Adelaide, and they all have their own different qualities. They are all worthy in their own right, I suppose. What I want from them is guidance, I guess, making sure that I keep focus on the right things in my project, and they're all doing that. And they're also providing me with opportunities to develop networks as well in areas that I'm interested in, which are really going to help me afterwards as well. And that's probably one of the better qualities from my supervisors, I think. So I think, you know, you've got to think about your supervisors in terms of what they can add now and, you know, potentially what they could add later as well, because they will certainly have an opinion about you afterwards and when you're applying for fellowships and jobs and things like that. So, and another thing I'll just add quickly, Pat, is to learn about managing your supervisors as well, because like Susan said, you know, they can often have differing opinions and you have to be able to manage any of those opinions and decide what's best for your project. So, yeah.
And Peter?
I have two co-supervisors. They are two probably of the more substantive reasons for why I decided to kind of do a PhD kind of at this point in time. I'd probably agree with much of what kind of Liz has kind of said. But I guess kind of within our research group, beyond kind of that direct supervision or that informal kind of mentorship that we get from our supervisors, we also have a lot of peer-to-peer mentorship from the early to mid-career level researchers within our group. We're kind of fortunate because we've got a very interdisciplinary group and all of them have a kind of a different set of skills. So beyond kind of just talking and debating with our supervisors in terms of our research direction, we also have this great opportunity to kind of interact with kind of other members of our team as well.
On that note, thank you for your questions, and we're going to move to the final part of the formal proceedings. But before we do that, would you please join me in thanking Peter, Susan and Liz.